Hi guys and girls, I hope you are having a wonderful day today. My name is Victor and my goal is to help you understand stuff. In this course, my goal is to help you understand Webpack, its main features and how you can use it in your projects. But before going further, let me first introduce myself. I'm a senior software engineer specializing in JavaScript and various technologies around it. I've been creating web applications for 16 years, and during these years I've learned a lot of useful stuff. Now I wanna share my knowledge with you. Now, when you already know a bit about me, let me walk you through the structure of this course. At the beginning, we are going to create a small application with only two JavaScript files. This application will serve us as a model on which we can apply different Webpack features and see how we can handle real-world use cases. Then, we are going to create a very basic Webpack configuration for this application. Then, we will have a look at loaders as well as asset modules and learn how to handle CSS, SAS, images, as well as other file types using Webpack. We will also have a look at how we can use latest cutting-edge JavaScript features in our applications, even though they are not implemented in all major browsers yet. After that, we'll have a look at Webpack plugins and learn how we can extract all our CSS into a separate bundle. We will also learn how Webpack helps us with browser caching and how we can generate HTML files automatically with all the assets we need. Then we are going to talk about code splitting, as well as handling multiple page applications in Webpack. After that, we will learn how to integrate Express.js framework for both single page applications and multiple page applications. Besides that, there is a whole section in this course dedicated to module federation. In that section, we are going to talk about module federation feature in Webpack, as well as about micro frontends in general. Micro frontend architecture allows you to split your main application into multiple micro frontends that can be developed by multiple teams and deployed independently. This will make your application super scalable. It seems we have a lot to cover here, so let's start this wonderful journey together. Let's talk about what you need in order to succeed in this course. First, you would need a computer, or tablet, or any other device capable of playing these videos. But ideally, you would need a computer or a laptop on which you can follow these videos and repeat all the actions that we are doing here. You must know basics of JavaScript. JavaScript is a must here because we will do a lot of JavaScript in this course. We will not do anything complex, but at least you must know basics. You must know basics of HTML. Even though we are going to have only a couple of HTML files, it would be very beneficial to you. By the way, HTML is very easy to learn. I know several people who learned the basics of it during a couple of days. That's all about musts. With this, you will be able to understand most of the things in this course. Everything else is nice to have. Those things will be needed if you want to understand Webpack deeply and learn faster. I really encourage you to repeat on your computer everything that we are going to do in this course. This is the best way to learn, and I can really recommend it. You would need a browser. Google Chrome, Firefox, Safari, Microsoft Edge, or any other browser that can execute JavaScript. By the way, Internet Explorer is also a browser. I'm going to use Google Chrome in these videos. You would need text editor. You can use any text editor of your choice. Visual Studio Code, Atom, WebStorm would be examples of popular editors nowadays. In these videos, I will be using Atom. You can download it on this website if you decide to use it as well. If you want to follow these videos and repeat everything that we are doing here, you would need to install Node.js. You can download it from this website. Node.js is a JavaScript environment that can execute JavaScript code on the backend. We are going to use Node.js in order to run Webpack from the terminal. And the last, not being afraid of terminal or command line. You should not be afraid of these things. Linux and Mac users have terminal installed by default in their systems, and Windows users can use CMDER, which is a console emulator for Windows. You can download CMDER from this website. Basically, that's all you need in this course. Enough introduction, let's proceed now to the core of the course. In this video, we will think about why. Why do we need Webpack at all? Back in the days when dinosaurs were walking on Earth and nobody heard about an iPhone, web applications looked like this. Here we can see that several CSS files are included at the top of the HTML file, but that is not the worst thing here. Do you see how many JavaScript files we are having here? 11! And some of them depend on each other. Of course, it's quite easy to tell that almost everything probably depends on common.js because of its name. But would you guess in the first 5 minutes that shipping.js depends on user.js because user.js handles the address of the customer? If you accidentally change the order of the JavaScript files, this project might break. When I only started my career, all web applications looked like this. But then we started to use Grunt and Gulp. These tools helped us to manage assets and concatenate all our JavaScript files into one. But they still cannot figure out dependencies between those files. In order to manage JavaScript dependencies, we used require.js, which helps in a way, but it's not as powerful as Webpack. Webpack is a static module bundler for modern JavaScript applications. When Webpack processes your application, it recursively builds a dependency graph that includes every module in your application and then packages all of those modules into one or more bundles. When I started using Webpack, most of my applications started to look like this. There are only 2 files here. One file for CSS and one file for JavaScript. There are no hidden dependencies. We don't have to worry about the correct order of the files anymore. There is only one JavaScript file we need to include. All dependencies, internal and external, are bundled inside this file. Basically, Webpack is a single tool for managing all your code as well as assets in one place. It can handle JavaScript, TypeScript, CoffeeScript, CSS, SAS, LESS, images, fonts, and so much more. In 3 words, Webpack is all in one. I think by this point you already know why we need Webpack. Let's go further and learn how to use it. In this video, we are going to create a basic setup for the future videos. We won't touch Webpack yet, so if you like, you can skip to the next video. We are going to create a simple project with only 3 files, one HTML file and 2 JavaScript files. I've already created an empty folder for our project called Tutorial, and I opened this empty folder in Atom Text Editor. Basically, you can use any editor of your choice, like Visual Studio Code, WebStorm, Sublime Text, etc. First, I'm going to create an HTML file named index.html, and I will paste here simple content that I prepared beforehand. This is a very simple HTML page. Nothing special is going on here. I'm specifying a title and a character set, which is UTF-8. Inside the body tag, I'm including 2 JavaScript files that we don't have at the moment, but I'm going to create them right now. I'm going to put these files into a separate folder called src, so I need to create this folder now. First, I'm going to create helloworld.js file. There will be only one function here called helloworld. This will be a pretty basic function. It will print a simple string "Hello World" to the browser console. This function is finished. Let's invoke this function. We are going to invoke it from another file that I'm going to create right now. This file will have a name index.js. So I will invoke "Hello World" function from this file. As you can see, the function definition is located inside hello-world.js, and we invoke this function from a different file, index.js. In other words, index.js depends on hello-world.js. Let's have a look how it works in the browser. I will copy the full path to our HTML file and paste it into the browser. I will paste it here, into the navigation bar. And at the moment we are having an empty page here, but if I open developer tools and have a look at the console tab, you will see a JavaScript error saying "Hello World" is not defined at index.js. So why do you think we are having this error? If I go back to the text editor and have a look at the index.js, I will see a function invocation here. However, the browser says that it's not defined. That's because the issue is not related to this file. The issue is related to our HTML file that has two script tags. You see, index.js is included before hello-world.js. However, it should be included after it, because inside index.js we are using a function that's defined inside hello-world.js. So here we are using hello-world function, and here this function is defined. Therefore, the order of these lines is wrong. I need to change the order. I need to put index.js after hello-world.js, so the function declaration comes before the function invocation. Let's have one more look at this tiny application in my browser and check if everything works now. I'm refreshing my page, and now we can see "Hello World" string in the browser console. So basically, we are done with our setup. We are going to build on these files in the future videos. In the next video, we are going to integrate Webpack into our small application. In the previous video, we created a simple application with one HTML file and two JavaScript files. In this video, we are going to install Webpack into this application. First of all, let's have a look at our HTML file. We are including only two JavaScript files inside, and we already have to reference them in a specific order. And we need to remember this order. What if I had 20 JavaScript files? Or 100 of JavaScript files. Maintaining such kind of a project would quickly become a nightmare. And these numbers are not exaggerated. For example, one of my latest projects has 75 internal modules and around 20 external libraries. Luckily, Webpack can manage all those dependencies for us and conveniently bundle them into a single JavaScript bundle that includes all the code needed for the application. Then you need to include this JavaScript bundle inside your HTML, and this bundle will contain all your dependencies. Now you don't have to remember which module to include first, which to include second, and so on. Webpack will sort that out for you. By the way, it doesn't have to be a single JavaScript bundle containing all your application code. Webpack can generate multiple bundles depending on your needs. We are going to cover different strategies for generating bundles later in this course. So let's install Webpack. But before that, we need to generate a package.json for our application. The package.json keeps track of all dependencies needed for the application. In order to do that, we need to go to the terminal and run a simple command. This command generates the default package.json for our application. Now I'm going to install Webpack. I'm installing two packages here. First one is Webpack. It's a package containing the core functionality of Webpack. And the second package is called webpack-cli. That's a command line tool, and it's used to run Webpack from the terminal. If you don't install this package, then you're going to be prompted to install it when running Webpack for the first time. And I'm using --save --dev option. This option will add Webpack to the package.json as a development dependency. If somebody else would like to work on the same application, they can easily find all the dependencies for this application listed inside the package.json. What's more, they will be able to install all those dependencies by executing a single command from the terminal. So now, when Webpack is installed, let's proceed to the next video and see how it can be used. In this video, we're gonna run Webpack and see how it works. However, before running Webpack, we need to make a couple of adjustments in our current codebase. First of all, let's go to the HTML file and remove one of the scripts. We don't need it anymore. From now on, we only need one JavaScript file, and this JavaScript file will include all our code. In order for this to work, we need to explicitly import all the dependencies inside the JavaScript code. So first, let's go to index.js and import hello world function. So before using the hello world function, we need to import it. I'm importing hello world function from hello-world.js, which is located inside the same folder as index.js. This dot here means that this path is relative to the file we are in. We also need to explicitly export hello world function from hello-world.js file. So I'm going to this file, and here, at the end of the file, I'm going to export hello world function. The syntax I'm using here is related to ECMAScript modules. ECMAScript modules is the current standard for working with JavaScript modules, and Webpack supports ECMAScript modules by default. Now let's go to the terminal and run Webpack. From the output in the terminal, I can see that this command has been successful. Here we just run Webpack without any configuration at all. Normally, you would provide a configuration file for Webpack. However, Webpack 5 uses the default configuration unless you provide a custom one. Generally, it's better to provide a custom configuration because it allows you to specify lots of useful options. And this way, it's much more convenient to store and maintain your configurations. You can also notice that Webpack complains that the mode option hasn't been set. Mode is a special option for Webpack that makes it much easier to set up different configurations for production and development use cases. We are going to talk about mode option later in this course. Here we can see that one file was generated, and this file is called main.js. Let's explore this file and see what we have inside. You can see that Webpack has created an output folder for us, and this folder is called dist. If you provide a custom configuration to Webpack, you will be able to choose the name of the output folder, as well as many other things that we are going to explore later in this course. Here you can see that main.js file contains the optimized version of our code. At this point, I would ask myself how Webpack figured out where to take this code from. Let me go back to the terminal and run Webpack one more time. This time I'm running Webpack with the stats option. This option will tell Webpack to print more details about the build process. If I scroll up, you will see that Webpack output says something about the entry point. The entry point is a file which Webpack uses as a starting point when building your application. This file would usually import other modules from the application. Here, Webpack assumes that the entry point is located inside the folder named src. Since the name of the file is not specified, Webpack will use index.js that's located inside the src folder as the entry point. Again, this is the default entry point, and you can easily change it when you provide your own configuration file to Webpack. So, in this video, we run Webpack and seen the results of its work. In the next video, we are going to create a custom configuration for Webpack. In this video, we are going to create a custom configuration for Webpack. Webpack stores its configuration in a JavaScript file, typically named webpack.config.js. You can choose a different name for the configuration file, but for now, let's use the default file name. So let's create this file. I'm going to create it in the root folder of our application. Let's specify basic Webpack configuration, which is going to be very similar to the default one. This file is basically a JavaScript module. Webpack expects this module to export the configuration object. Inside this object, we can specify many useful configuration options. In this video, we are going to touch only the most basic ones. We are going to explore dozens of other options later in this course. So our first option is going to be an entry point. This file usually imports all other modules in your application. Webpack will start from this file when running the build process. In our case, this is index.js. The second option is an output file. Here we can specify a name of the file which will be generated as a result of the build process and pass to the directory where this file should be generated. In our case, this is bundle.js and it will be generated inside the directory named dist. So after Webpack runs, it will generate a file called bundle.js inside of the folder called dist. Webpack will automatically create this folder if it doesn't exist. And the last mandatory option is mode. For now, I will specify none here, but later in this course, I will explain why we need this option and how to use it. This is the minimal sensible configuration file. Let's run Webpack and see if this works. It turns out there is an error in our configuration. This error is quite popular, and that's why I'm showing it in this video. I hope if you encounter such an error unintentionally, you will know how to fix it. What this error means is that we specified a relative path in the output path configuration option, but instead we needed to specify an absolute path. Let's go to our IDE and fix that. There is a Node.js package that can help us to generate an absolute path. Let's import this package. Please note that here I'm using the old way of importing modules, common.js, because inside the configuration file we can't use ECMAScript modules. It was always like that, and it's still the case in Webpack 5. So what I need to do now is I need to replace this relative path with an absolute path. Path.resolve converts a sequence of path segments into an absolute path. As the first argument, I will specify the current folder, and as the second argument, I will specify the relative path to the dist folder. Let's run Webpack one more time and see if it picks up our configuration. First, I will remove the existing dist folder that was generated during the previous runs. Now we are ready to run Webpack again. This time everything went well. Let's take a look inside the list folder. As you can see, the name of the bundle file differs from the default one. If you remember, when we run Webpack with no configuration, it generated a file called main.js. But this time the name of this file is bundle.js, as we specified in the configuration file. This means that Webpack no longer uses the default configuration, instead it uses the custom configuration that we provided. By the way, if I go to the HTML file, I can see that we are referencing the wrong file in the script tag. At the moment we are still referencing index.js. But that's not the case anymore, because what we actually need is a resulting bundle generated by Webpack. Every time I run Webpack, it generates a JavaScript bundle inside the list folder, and here I need to reference this bundle. This is what we specified inside the configuration file. Now let's go to the browser and check if our application still works. And you can see the Hello World message in the browser console. As you can see, the application still works, and now we are using code generated by Webpack. In order to run Webpack more conveniently, we can create a script inside package.json. If I go to the package.json, I will see a list of scripts here. By default, there is only a test script, which does nothing. It was automatically generated when we created our package.json. So I will add a new script here and I will call it build. Every time we run this script, it will run Webpack for us. So in this video, we created a custom configuration for Webpack. This configuration is very similar to the default one, and it's not doing much at the moment. In the next sections of this course, we are going to explore a lot of various configuration options that you can provide to Webpack. Basically, Webpack allows you to import lots of different stuff into your JavaScript code. This is possible due to a couple of great features that Webpack provides. First one is asset modules, and the second one is loaders. In this section, we are going to talk about asset modules feature. Asset modules is a new feature introduced in Webpack 5. It allows you to easily use asset files in your JavaScript application without installing additional dependencies. However, you still need to make changes to your Webpack configuration in order to teach Webpack how to import those asset files. By the way, what kind of asset files I'm talking about? In this case, I'm talking about various kinds of images, fonts, or plain text files. All those files can be processed by Webpack using asset modules. There are four types of asset modules you can use. First one is called asset resource. Asset resource module type emits your file into the output directory and exports the URL to that file. In this course, we are using dist as the output directory. This type of asset module can be used to import large images or large font files, for example. The second type of asset module is called asset inline. Asset inline module type inlines a file into the bundle as a data URI. This asset module can be used when importing small asset files like SVGs, for example. Usually, SVGs are injected into the JavaScript bundle as the data URI, and you can use asset inline for that. Please note that this type of asset module doesn't generate a new file in the output folder. There is also a general asset type, which serves as a combination of the previous two asset types. If you decide to use a general asset type, Webpack will automatically choose between asset resource and asset inline. If the file size is less than 8 kilobytes, this file will be treated as inline asset module, and if the file size is more than 8 kilobytes, this file will be treated as a resource asset module. Of course, it's possible to change this magic number from 8 kilobytes to anything you want. Sometimes you just need to import some plain text data as a JavaScript string. For example, you have a text file that stores some data as plain text. You can use AssetSource module type in order to import such kind of data. AssetSource imports the source code of the file as it is and injects it into the JavaScript bundle as a string of text. So in this video we learned about asset modules in general and what kinds of asset modules exist in Webpack. In the following videos we are going to have a look at each type of asset modules. In the previous video I've told you that you can import lots of different stuff using Webpack. So let's get crazy today and import an image. Yes, Webpack made it possible to import images right into your JavaScript code. I've already placed an image inside src folder. This image is called kiwi.jpg. Let's create a new JavaScript file where we will be adding that image to the document object model. I will call this file addImage.js. Inside this file, I will create a function which will add an image to the document object model. I will call this function addImage. Inside this function, I will create an img DOM element, specify an alternate text, width, and src properties. But what should I put inside the src property? Now it's time to import our image. Now Kiwi contains the public URL to the file, and we can simply assign it to the img.src. Let's add our newly created img DOM element to the body DOM element. Don't forget to export our function, because we need to import it inside index.js. Now let's go to the index.js and import addImage function. I will add it right after I import hello world function. Now we need to invoke addImage function. So the coding part is done, but Webpack doesn't know yet how to import this image. We still need to teach Webpack how to import image files. Now we need to go to the Webpack configuration file and add a special rule which will tell Webpack how to import image files. Inside the Webpack configuration file we need to add a new property. This property is called module and this is a JavaScript object. Inside this object we will have another property called rules. And rules simply contains an array of specific rules. Each rule is an object itself. It has at least two properties. First one is test. Here I will write a regular expression. This regular expression will match png and jpg files. It checks if the file name contains either .png or .jpg. The second property should be either type or use. In this section we are talking about asset modules which require the type property. We are going to talk about the use property in the next section of this course, when we'll talking about loaders. Type property can accept one of four values: asset resource, asset inline, asset source, and asset. This time we will use asset resource module type. We are going to talk about the other module types in the next videos of this section. So, every time we try to import a JPG file, Webpack will check if it has a rule for it. If it doesn't find a suitable rule, it will give an error which means something like the following: Hey, unfortunately, I don't know how to import this file. Please tell me what I should do with it. On the other hand, if it finds a rule for this file, it will import the file according to the rule. So let's imagine that we have more than one rule. I will add one more rule to our configuration file just for the purpose of this example. Let's see how Webpack handles importing of the new file. It thinks the following way. I need to import a file called kiwi.jpg. Do I know by heart how to import JPG files? For some files, Webpack knows how to import them by heart, even without specifying any rules at all. For example, JavaScript files or JSON files. You can import JavaScript files right away, without specifying additional rules. But let's listen to Webpack further. No, I don't know how to import JPG files. Let's have a look at my rules. It seems I have two rules. Let's have a look at the first one. Is it applicable to JPG files? No, it's applicable to TTF files, and we have a JPG file here. Let's have a look at the next rule. Is it applicable to JPG files? Yes, this time it is applicable to both JPG and PNG files. Therefore, it's applicable to our JPG file. So I will use this rule. What should I do according to this rule? It seems I need to use asset resource module type in order to import this file. So I will do that. I will use asset resource. There are multiple asset module types that you can use here. In this case, we are using asset resource module type, which instructs Webpack to copy the required file into the output directory. In our case, the output directory is called dist. By default, the name of the resulting file is the md4 hash of the contents of this file with the original extension. Now I need to remove the first rule from here. We don't need it anymore. It was needed just for the purpose of this demonstration. Now we can try to run Webpack in the terminal. Our build is finished and there are no errors. Let's go to the browser and check what we have there. As you can see, here is our image. So in this video, we successfully imported an image into the JavaScript file and became familiar with asset modules. Earlier in this course, I told you that Webpack allows you to import lots of different stuff into your JavaScript code. This is possible due to a couple of great features that Webpack provides. In the previous section, we were talking about asset modules, which allow you to import images, fonts, or plain text files. In this section, we are going to talk about Webpack loaders. Loaders allow you to import all other kinds of files that you can't import using asset modules. Webpack was designed to help you bundle all your dependencies into one or more files. What kind of dependencies are we talking about? Usually, dependencies are other JavaScript modules that your main JavaScript file requires in order to do its job. But we can do more than that. With Webpack, you can import CSS files right into your JavaScript code. You can import SAS, LESS, handlebars, XML, and so much more. There are a lot of things you can import using Webpack. And Webpack loaders are JavaScript libraries that help you import all that stuff. In the next videos, we are going to talk about various loaders that you most probably will use in your projects.